morning, and can I welcome you on this Palm Sunday to the Parish of Christ the King, into this service for Palm Sunday, as we prepare to accompany Jesus and his disciples through the life-changing events of this Holy Week. May I firstly send greetings to you and to your families, and trust that you are keeping well, and that this period of enforced isolation is not proving too stressful. We are mindful at this time of all those who are suffering or who are seriously ill or who have died as a result of the virus, and we keep them in our prayers as we gather together. We also give thanks for all those who are caring for the sick and for the risks that they themselves are taking. If this were a normal Palm Sunday, we would be starting with a procession, having blessed our palm crosses. A procession is difficult to accept within the confines of our own homes and gardens, but we can still bless the palm crosses that were prepared for today, and I invite you to collect one of these from St. Aidan's Church as soon as we are able to gather together. We are reminded in today's service that Jesus arrives in Jerusalem to great rejoicing as a fearful people are longing for a Saviour who will release them from their sense of oppression and give them fresh hope for the future. But the rejoicing and shouting of Hosanna and triumphal entry of Jesus are, within a few days, turned into cries of crucify, as a fickle crowd are manipulated by the religious authorities of the day. We too are caught up in this dramatic turnaround this morning as we hear the account of Jesus's passion and death in a dramatised reading of Matthew's Gospel. For some reason, the nature and pattern of God's love that Jesus came to reveal to the world was rejected by the forces of fear and self-interest. But times like these do remind us that the fear and self-interest, although they are ever present, do not have the final word. Goodness, sacrificial love and hope win the day, although we have to go through some heartache and pain to discover that truth. I hope that you sense that even amongst all the clamouring voices of these days, that the eternal truth of the victory of love is standing out for all to see. So, let us begin our Easter journey as we come to hear again the events of that Palm Sunday nearly 2,000 years ago. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Dear friends in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing for the works by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today we come together to begin this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that united with him in his sufferings, we may share his risen life. God, our Saviour, whose Son Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem as Messiah, to suffer and to die, let these palms be for us a sign of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns with you and the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And so we hear the Palm Gospel according to Matthew.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this: the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? The crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. And so we sing our opening hymn, ride on in majesty, as we make our own procession, wherever that may be. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we hear our reading from the Old Testament, from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backwards. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me, who will declare me guilty. All of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our New Testament lesson is taken from the letter to the Philippians, chapter 2. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God has exalted him highly and given him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And so we sing the hymn, My Song is Love Unknown. Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
What will you give me if I betray Jesus to you?
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying,
Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?
Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, The teacher says, My time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.
So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me."
And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another,
"Surely not I, Lord."
"Surely not I, Lord."
"The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said,
"Take, eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Though all become deserted because of me, I will never desert you."
"Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times."
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want."
Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
"So, could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away for the second time and prayed,
"My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done."
Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
"The one I will kiss is a man. Arrest him."
At once he came up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi,"
and kissed him. Jesus said to him,
"Friend, do what you are here to do."
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you not think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place, so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so that they might put him to death, but they found none. Though many false witnesses came forward, at last two came forward and said,
"This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.'"
The high priest stood up and said,
"Have you no answer? What is this that they testify against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him,
"You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard this blasphemy. What is your verdict?"
They answered,
"He deserves death."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying,
"Prophesy to us, you Messiah. Who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said,
"You also were with Jesus the Galilean."
But he denied it before all of them, saying,
"I do not know what you're talking about."
When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders,
"This man was with Jesus of Nazareth."
Again, he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you."
Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know the man."
At that moment the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, and he went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said,
"I have sinned by betraying innocent blood."
But they said,
"What is that to us? See to it yourself."
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
"It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money."
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"You say so."
When he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?"
But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him,
"Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him."
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
"Barabbas."
"Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?"
"Let him be crucified."
"Why? What evil has he done?"
"Let him be crucified."
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves."
"His blood be on us and on our children."
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. When he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him." Said God, "Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. I am God's son."
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?
That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
This man is calling for Elijah.
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said,
Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
Surely this man was God's son.
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
So, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive, that after 3 days I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people he had been raised from the dead. The deception will be worse than the first.
Pilate said to them,
You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can.
So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone.
This is the Passion of the Lord. Let us bring our prayers for the world and for each other before our crucified Christ. Let us bring prayers to the Father, our prayers of his intercession through Christ, who gave himself for the life of the world. Today we particularly remember all those who are suffering, those who are caring, and those who are dying, as we come before Christ and open our hearts to him.
For forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For grace to seek out those habits of sin which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christian people, that through the suffering of disunity, there may grow a rich union in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who make laws, interpret them, and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who still make Jerusalem a battleground, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
for those who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in the darkness and agony of separation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who, weighed down with hardship, failure, or sorrow, feel that God is far from them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. And so we bring our prayers together in the words that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the power, the kingdom, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. In the knowledge that we are the body of Christ and Christ is with us now, so we share together in the peace. Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you,
and also with you.
Let us offer one another, wherever we may be, within the confines of our own separation and isolation, a sign of peace. Mindful that we cannot gather round this table in bread and wine as would be our wish and want, we gather in the knowledge that we are the body of Christ and we share together in this spiritual communion. People who come together from wherever are included and welcomed as we gather together as one. So let us pray. Jesus, the true vine and bread of life, ever giving yourself that the world might live, let us share in your death and passion. Make us perfect in your love. Amen.
Amen.
Give thanks for the saving death and resurrection of Jesus and ask him to be with you now. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. Lord, in these days of mercy, make us quiet and prayerful. In these days of challenge, make us stronger in you. In these days of emptiness, take possession of us. In these days of waiting, open our hearts to the mystery of your cross. So as we draw this service to a close, can I thank you for being with us today and hope that you'll continue to share with us during this week. We have services planned for every day this week. Already we have planned for reflections and compline for Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday, which you'll be able to find on YouTube. and we plan and hope to have something available for Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, and for Saturday and Sunday. And we hope that as you join us during this week, so that you too will have something of the experience of this Holy Week and all that Christ has done for us and all the hope that lies ahead. And so we finish with a blessing. Christ crucified, draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you and all those whom you love, this day and always. Amen.
Amen.
And so we finish with our final hymn, I Will Sing the Wondrous Story. To take up your cross and follow Christ. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.